Good morning, or afternoon, or evening, whenever it is that you are plugging in today. Welcome to worship at Emmanuel Lutheran Church on this, the fifth Sunday in Lent. My name is Jim Grunow, and I continue to serve unofficially as the interim before our interim pastor arrives next week. I will be presiding today. And our preacher, our guest preacher, is the Reverend Misael Fajardo Perez. He is a participant in our Synod's Color Amazed Preaching Project, and he will be introduced shortly by Pastor David Haven. We gather today for worship in the aftermath of another mass shooting, this one taking place in Atlanta, Georgia, on Tuesday of this week, where six of the eight persons killed were Asian American women. It's especially appropriate in this context today that we welcome a person of color to deliver the message. And you should know that his message was prepared and delivered before this mass shooting took place. Pastor Perez will explore the metaphor in today's gospel of a grain of wheat falling into the earth and dying. He will remind us of Jesus' words, "Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, there my servant will be also." Jesus is with the families of those victims in Atlanta, Georgia, this morning. And because the prayers were already recorded before this shooting took place, I would like to begin now by offering a word of prayer for the families of those victims. So let us pray. O God, in your Son Jesus, you promise to be with those who suffer. We ask you today to enter into the pain and suffering of the families who lost loved ones in the mass shooting in Atlanta this week. Walk with them in their tears. Hold them in their grief. Bring an end to the senseless violence and killings that happen all too often in our land. Teach us to live together in peace as your beloved children. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's now keep a few moments of silence as we prepare for worship.
Greetings, people of the Northwest Intermountain Synod. I'm Dave Haven, pastor of Celebration Lutheran Church in East Wenatchee, Washington. It's my pleasure to introduce today's Color Amazed preacher. Many of you know his name and face, Reverend Misael Fajardo Perez. I was privileged to be Misael's supervising pastor while he was an intern pastor at Celebration Lutheran. And after completing internship, he went on to serve as the mission developer for the Wenatchee Valley Lutheran Latino Ministry. Misael and I formed a deep friendship during his years in our valley, sharing rich experiences in and out of the church, from skiing and biking and hiking and road trips, to planning community festivals, youth retreats, and joint worship services, there was never a dull moment. Pastor Misael is one of the most humble, genuine, and gracious people I know. He is truly a bridge builder who continues to forge solid connections amongst the people he encounters, just as he did as part of the Wenatchee Valley and our Synod. His deep faith and genuine notion of the grace of God serves the gospel well, as others are drawn to the good news he shares via his ministry and his life. Originally from Mexico City, Misael came to the United States when he was 18 years old. He attended Trinity Lutheran College in Issaquah, Washington. After graduation, he was called to work with the people in the Yakima Valley at Tree of Life Lutheran in a multicultural context. He went on to earn his Master's of Divinity from Pacific Lutheran Theological Seminary in Berkeley, graduating in May of 2013 with a concentration in evangelism and justice. Currently, Pastor Misael serves in the ELCA's Pacifica Synod with St. Peter Lutheran in Santa Ana, California. Welcome back, Pastor Misael Fajardo Perez. It's good to have you back.
Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the keeper of the covenant, the source of steadfast love, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. God hears us when we cry and draws us close in Jesus Christ. Let us return to the one who is full of compassion. Fountain of living water, pour out your mercy over us. Our sin is heavy, and we long to be free. Rebuild what we have ruined, and mend what we have torn. Wash us in your cleansing flood. Make us alive in the Spirit to follow in the way of Jesus as healers and restorers of the world you so love. Amen. Well, beloved, God's word never fails. The promise rests on grace. By the saving love of Jesus Christ, the wisdom and power of God, your sins and mine are forgiven, and God remembers them no more. Journey in the way of Jesus. Amen. Let us pray. God, with steadfast love you draw us to yourself, and in mercy you receive our prayers. Strengthen us to bring forth the fruits of the Spirit, that through life and to death we may live in your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Good morning. What have we been talking about for all of Lent?
God keeps promises.
That's right. We've been talking about the promises God makes and keeps. One word God uses for the word promise is covenant. God used that word with each promise to Noah, Abraham, and Moses. And in our story today from Jeremiah, God makes another promise or covenant. You can follow along on your Spark Story Bible on page 178. Israelites are people who followed Moses to the Promised Land. God chose the Israelites to be special people. They lived in a country called Israel, and God gave them a good ruler named King David. Some of the kings who ruled after King David were not very good. These kings made the Israelites so sad that they forgot about God. There was much trouble in their country. However, God did not forget about them. God sent a man named Jeremiah to give the Israelites hope. Jeremiah said, "Soon God's promise to save the world will be kept. When the right time comes, God will send a leader from King David's family, and he will be a good ruler." "Hooray!" shouted the people. "God remembers us." The people were hopeful. Everything would be good again, and the people could hardly wait. The story doesn't tell us who this leader Jeremiah is talking about is, but you might have a guess about who Jeremiah is talking about. Do you know who it is? I'll give you a hint. That's right. It's Jesus. Jesus is the leader God promised. In the next couple of weeks, we're going to learn about this new covenant or new promise that God made through Jesus. And today, I want you to pay attention really close to the service. I want you to listen for the words new covenant and try to remember what part of the service is happening when you hear those words. And then we'll talk about that some more in the coming weeks. Let's pray. Good and merciful God, we thank you for all of the stories that teach us.
God keeps promises.
We thank you for Jesus, another reminder that
God keeps promises.
Help us to remember
God keeps promises.
And that we are your beloved children forever. Amen.
A reading from Jeremiah. "The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. It will not be like the covenant that I made with their ancestors when I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, a covenant that they broke, though I was their husband, says the Lord. But this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my law within them, and I will write it on their hearts. And I will be their God, and they shall be my people. No longer shall they teach one another or say to each other, 'Know the Lord,' for they shall all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, says the Lord. For I will forgive their iniquity and remember their sin no more." Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God.
In the law of the Lord. Happy are those who follow in the law of the Lord. Be good to your servants that I may live to keep your word. Open my heart that I may consider the wonders are they who walk in the law of the Lord. Happy are those who follow in the law of the Lord. Happy are those who follow in the law of the Lord. Instruct me, O God, in the way of your statutes, that I may exactly observe them. Give me discernment, that I may observe your law. Give me discernment to keep it with all my heart. Happy are they who walk in the law of the Lord. Happy are those who follow in the law of the Lord. Happy are those who follow in the law of the Lord.
The Gospel for the fifth Sunday in Lent comes from the Gospel of John, the 12th chapter. Now, among those who went up to worship at the festival were some Greeks. They came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, and said to him, "Sir, we wish to see Jesus." Philip went and told Andrew, and Andrew and Philip went and told Jesus. Jesus answered them, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Very truly I tell you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains just a single grain. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. Those who love their life lose it, and those who hate their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, there will my servant be also. Whoever serves me, the Father will honor. Now my soul is troubled. And what should I say? Father, save me from this hour? No, it is for this reason that I have come to this hour. Father, glorify your name." Then a voice came from heaven, "I have glorified it, and I will glorify it again." The crowd standing then heard it and said that it was thunder. Others said, "An angel has spoken to him." Jesus answered, "This voice has come for your sake, not for mine. Now is the judgment of this world. Now the ruler of this world will be driven out. And I, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to myself." He said this to indicate the kind of death he was to die. The Gospel of the Lord. My first thought about this gospel was, someone was just trying to talk to Jesus, that is all. And Jesus goes on with this long poetic talk that, to be honest, it confused me, as I am sure it confused the Greeks, the disciples, those around him. But there is much rich language that will be a mistake not to spend time on this language, on this metaphor. Jesus was moving closer to his salvific work at the cross, and it seemed that the more he became closer to the cross, the more his words pointed at his suffering, death, and resurrection. But what I like today to focus on is this metaphor of the grain of wheat. And I am grateful that I can connect more to this agricultural language thanks to my time in the Eastern Washington, Idaho Synod, because I learned so much about the organic growth of seeds and plants. And when I read about these passages, I'm grateful because all these passages that contain agricultural images really come alive and really connect with this organic process that I came to learn hands-on. You'll know that in order for the seed to grow and for it to multiply and to feed many abundantly, it must die. Otherwise, it will remain a simple grain. It will remain a grain with no purpose, a grain that seeks its own survival, a grain that eventually will dry it up. Have you ever felt like that? Has your church ever felt like that? Dried up. Just going along, trying to survive. Really not focused on our purpose. Ever since I was a youth, I felt driven by a future. I knew I was called by God to something greater than my own normal reality. Something filled with a purpose, but was not sure what exactly that looked like. By faith, I accepted to be an international student at Trinity Lutheran College when it existed. Some of you may know it as the Lutheran Bible Institute. After high school, I decided to leave my home country in Mexico, Mexico City, and to enter into this college, this community of faith, not knowing the language, not knowing the people that I would be with. This journey has not been easy. An immigration story marked by many unknowns, many changes. I can tell you that it was very tempting to not move forward at times. And if there was a hole in a sand or in the dirt, at times I would have put my head in there and avoid all the changes in my life, all the challenges that comes from being an immigrant. But God provided me always with a community of faith, a community of love and forgiveness, a community of God's loving kind. There was always beside me in my ministry life a community of faith. You see, when we live through so many changes, it is tempting and convenient to put ourselves in a situation where we just live comfortably. But God has always called God's people out on a journey since the time of Abraham, Moses, a life of continued growth, much like a seed that grows naturally with sunlight and water and good soil. I am participating in this project to uplift the voices of siblings of Christ who are part of our church, whose color of skin is different than most congregants, whose identity comes from places other than white European descent. And this is evident that our church is changing. The world has changed for a while now. Jesus is inviting his disciples to trust him, to trust the future that God has for them. He's not asking nothing else but to follow him to places that he will lead them. And if I think of those places that Jesus may be leading his disciples, it might be those places where they had no control over, a place where they might be the ones with no answers. They might be the ones where they won't understand the language. A place where time might not be the most important, but community might be. A place where people might not know perhaps how to read music or even read, but they are as smart as these disciples and you and I. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, there will my servant be also. These are words of invitation to trust and follow what God will do by continuing to follow Jesus. And these are indeed words of promise that God in Christ will be with you and I as he was with his disciples. The good news is that we have already been provided with good soil, with the gift of water and the sunlight and all the basic components for growth. We have good roots. The Holy Spirit and the Word of God are the way our communities will grow. We are invited now to labor and to dive into the future God wants for Christ's church, even if that future looks differently, or even if the church is led by people who look different than you and me. Dear siblings in Christ, nothing else matters. Our sins are forgiven. I want you to hear me clear. God remembers them no more. God remembers not the sin of our past, of our presence, and God will forgive those in the future. Because we have a God who is love and mercy and forgiveness. So now what? Now we look up into the bright future and we join Jesus and we follow him into those communities that we will experience this presence of Christ. And I can tell you this because I have done it. I have been and continue to feel called to minister to those outside of my own. Oftentimes I feel called to minister and to walk with white European descent congregations. I have witnessed the love of Christ when engaged with others outside of my own. I have learned much from unknown encounters, and I have seen the fruits of those encounters. There is no doubt that God will lead us over and over again to resurrection life. In Christ Jesus, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
Love to O God, we lament that over the past months many Christians have not been able to assemble in person for worship. Many believers have languished alone, and we pray, strengthen all Christians in every church around the globe in the covenant of their baptism. Equip children and teachers in Sunday school, confirmation, and service projects, whether online or in person. We lament that by indulging our own desires, we have misused your creation and have worsened the poverty of others. And we pray, continue your care for the earth you have made, protect animals and their habitats, grant weather that prepares the soil for seeds, and shelter all lands from violent storms, flooding, and wildfires. We lament that as a nation we have not ensured justice for all and equal access to freedoms and to the necessities of life. We lament ongoing prejudices and violence on our streets and in our homes. And we pray, bring an end to warfare and terrorism. Imbue our courts with truth and wisdom. Guide citizens throughout the world to shape communities that reflect your mercy, justice, and peace, and give them creativity to work for the welfare of all. We lament the sufferings of people the world over. We lament the sorrows of the pandemic. We lament hunger, homelessness, and loneliness. And we pray, end this pandemic. Provide vaccinations to all persons around the earth. Guide us in healing the sick, welcoming the migrant, feeding the hungry, and living with others in harmony. We pray for those we name in our hearts. We lament the hopelessness that afflicts so many people. We lament the anguish of refugee camps, of overcrowded hospitals, of unhappy homes. And we pray, as this Thursday we celebrate the Annunciation of the birth of Jesus to Mary, instill in us gratitude for your presence among mankind, for holding us through sorrow, and for leading us into joy. We lament our secret sorrows known only to you, and that we ask you to receive the prayers of our hearts. We lament the countless who have died of COVID and the diminishment of life that so many have endured. We praise you for those who have given us words for our lament and our praise, especially today, Thomas Cranmer, who oversaw the creation of the Book of Common Prayer. At the end, bring us with all who have died in Christ into your everlasting presence. We entrust ourselves and all our prayers to you, Father of glory, in your bountiful spirit, in the name of Christ, our great high priest, now and forever. Amen.
Having heard the living word of God, let us now taste the presence of our living Lord in this meal that he has prepared for us. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks unto the Lord our God. Holy God, our living water and our merciful guide, Together with rivers and seas, wells and springs, we bless and magnify you. You led your people Israel through the desert and provided them water from the rock. We praise you for Christ, our rock and our water, who joins us in our deserts, pouring out his life for the world. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in the remembrance of me." And then again after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering, therefore, his life, death, and resurrection, we await your salvation, O Lord, for all this thirsty world. Pour out your Spirit on this holy food and on all who are gathered here for this feast. Wash away our sin, that we may be revived for our journey by the love of Christ. Through him all glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father, with the Holy Spirit and your holy church, both now and forever. Amen. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus has taught us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sinned against us. Save us from the time of trial, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. The gifts of God for the people of God. Our crucified and living Lord invites all who are hungry and thirsty for him to share in this meal today. Please know that the bread you take where you're at in your homes is the body of Christ. So take and eat. Please know that the wine you drink is indeed the blood of Christ. Take and drink. And now may this true body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in God's grace today and forever. Amen. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine upon you with grace and favor. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.
Go in peace. Share God's gift of love with all. Thanks be to God.
I will walk in the presence of the Lord. In the land of the living, yes, in the presence of the Lord.
Voices.
Hey everybody, happy spring, happy Lent. This is my favorite time of the year and I'm really getting excited to get back outside and get working in the yards. And if you're sharing the same feelings as I am, I invite you to come out here to Emmanuel Lutheran Church, March 27th, Saturday, 9 a.m. and join me for a couple of hours in the morning to clean up the yard and get ready for Easter. We'll see you there. Thank you.
land of the living, yes, in the presence of the Lord. I will walk in the presence of the Lord, in the land of the living, yes, in the presence of the Lord.